So we're really excited to be able to introduce the moderators for our first panel session. Our first session is titled Defining Priorities and Needs to Achieve Career and Personal Goals. And with that, I'm going to introduce Dr. Andrea Mortensen and Dr. Stephanie Matt.
Hello, everyone. My name is Andrea Mortensen. I'm very happy to be here today. I will be co-moderating this session with Dr. Stephanie Matt. And I am an assistant professor of pharmacology and physiology. Currently, my lab is comprised of 8 women, 9 with me. And I want to say that we are come from all different backgrounds and we are all in different stages of our career. So we are all very excited for this session today, for the whole event today. And we're looking forward to this discussion.
And hi, everyone. My name is Dr. Stephanie Matt. I'm a postdoc working with an incredibly supportive mentor, Dr. Peter Gaskill, for the past 5 years. I'm also in the Department of Pharmacology and Physiology at Drexel here with the College of Medicine. This is my first year as a postdoc representative for WIMSC, and just really excited to kick off the first session co-chairing with Andrea today. As Vanessa said, this session is entitled Priorities for Career and Personal Goals, and the objectives are to develop strategies to define priorities in our careers and personal lives, characterize changes in priorities, especially over the last 5 years, and to create an understanding that priorities and goals evolve across our careers. We really want to emphasize here in the session today that setting priorities is an iterative process that is constantly evolving, and we think it's really important to have continual readjustment and reevaluation over time. We have an outstanding group of experts in career development and leaders in academic medicine as panelists today to guide this session, including Dr. Chiquita Collins, Dr. Sharon Hull, and Dr. Ana Lopez-Fuentes. We will start off with introductions from the panelists and a word cloud activity to guide some of our initial questions we have prepared, but we'll also include an audience question and answer as well. So we really hope this session is going to be as interactive as possible.
And before we start, I would like to say that if you registered before today, you should have received an email with a worksheet attachment entitled What Matters Most to You, a Workbook for Creating an International Life. And I believe that Vanessa is also putting in the chat for everyone. If you had a chance to go through it before today, it's great. I did it and I really enjoy it. But if you didn't, that's okay. We're going to discuss it during today's event. And we can also serve as a post-event activity for you that I'm sure will be very helpful for you. And so I can see that Vanessa had put in the chat the workbook by the wonderful Dr. Sharon Hull, which is here with us, and also the word cloud. So if everyone could click on the word cloud link and think about something that you prioritize in your life. It could be personal, like family, or professional, such as promotion, such as research, or something that is significant to you, and you drop it in the chat now. And while everyone is going through the word cloud, we would take this chance to have our panelists today introduce themselves. So I would like that Dr. Chiquita Collins, if you could introduce yourself to us.
Sure. Hello and welcome. I'm honored to be part of this conversation amongst stellar peers in the field. I am the inaugural Vice President for Diversity, Equity, Inclusion at UT Health San Antonio, serving also as the Chief Diversity Officer, and I'm an Associate Professor in Population Health Sciences. I'm a trained demographer, so I'm a social scientist that is somewhat unique in academic medicine, but I have had many leadership roles locally, regionally, and nationally as pertains to advancing women in medicine and science. I serve on the steering committee of the AAMC Group on Women in Medicine and Science for many years, and I am now the current chair for the Group on Diversity and Inclusion for the Association of American Medical Colleges. So I'll stop there.
That's wonderful. Thank you very much. Dr. Sharon Hull, if you could please tell us a little bit about yourself.
Certainly, I'm happy to do that. It's hard to follow in Chiquita's footsteps. It's also hard to follow in the footsteps of Dr. Gold. I was so inspired by her speech that, Nancy, I'm glad you're collecting that for the archives. So I am Sharon Hull. I am the founder of Metta Solutions, which is a coaching, consulting, and community building company. And I'm a retired family physician and public health physician who spent nearly 30 years in academic medicine in a variety of leadership roles. The last 10 years or so of my academic career, I also had the opportunity to develop what I now call my encore career as a professional executive coach. So this is my encore, and I'm delighted to be here with you. My focus as a coach is on leadership development and career strategies for the most part. And I'm excited to be part of this conversation today with fantastic colleagues.
That's wonderful. Thank you. And then last, but certainly not least, Dr. Ana Lopez-Fuentes, could you please tell us a little bit about yourself?
Yes. Good afternoon. It's an honor and a privilege to be here. I'm Dr. Ana Lopez-Fuentes. I'm a professor and the former dean of the dental school in the University of Puerto Rico in Puerto Rico. And I'm also the chair-elect for the American Dental Education Association, which is ADEA, the counterpart of the AAMC. I'll start my presidency this next March, in a month, and it's an honor to and a privilege. I'm the first Puerto Rican male or female to have this position, and only the 10th woman in a 100-year history of ADEA. I was also the second woman dean in a 67-year history of my dental school. So it's like breaking barriers and blazing new trails for women in dentistry and oral health. I was also co-chair of the DEIB group at ADEA, and I helped start the Women in Leadership section, which is like the WIMSC counterpart at ADEA, which has been an honor to work with. A past ELAM and a past faculty advisor for ELAM. So it's great to be here among friends and colleagues. Thank you.
Okay, those were wonderful introductions. And hopefully everyone's had some time to at least put one of their priorities in the word cloud. So we're gonna show this here. And to start off with the first questions, and this can be directed at all of the panelists. Is there anything surprising that you see here in this world cloud of priorities? What did you expect to be here that you didn't see?
Well, as I'm looking at it, I am struck by something that my clients often tell me when they do a list of their priorities, which is that many of these things are not related to work. And that's not a surprise to me, but it often is to the people who make their own list of priorities. Doesn't mean that work's not important. It's just that if I ask them to make a top 10 list, their surprise, as they report it to me, is that the first 4 to 6 items are often not work. So I'll be interested to hear what others have to say about that.
If I may say, I agree, but it's not a surprise for me. After we have been through so much in the past 3-5 years, and we have refocused our priorities, and we have moved into rethinking what our priorities should be. Although we have definitely to balance work and family life, our health, wellness, and mental health have come right and center in order for us to be productive and to be there for our loved ones.
I would add, it's interesting to see, although they're smaller in size in terms of mentoring, I see differentiation between mentoring of students versus mentoring, which I would imply what type of effective mentoring that you may have received in terms of your professional careers. And so mentoring has many connotations, and I hopefully will have further discussion. What I didn't see, but again, it's moving around every so many seconds. The issue of sponsorship, you know, that is a term that we embrace as it pertains to individuals who are of high stature, who are advocating on the behalf of someone else in terms of the progression of their career. So I think that is something that it is of importance, primarily as pertains to women. in academic medicine and in other industries as well.
I would add that while many of the largest items on the word cloud are mental health, family health, wellness, research, career advancement, there are a number of things here that are work-related. And I think as this group gets into the conversation with us, I'm going to be very interested to hear how you balance those priorities. This is work-life balance writ large, as far as I'm in a visual, as far as I'm concerned.
That was a good discussion. And one question we were always thinking when we were planning for this section is, was there a time that you wish you had prioritized it differently in either your personal or your professional lives, or perhaps the intersection of those two? Mm-hmm. For all the three panelists, this question.
I have been moved to by circumstances in our lifetime I was able to prioritize the right way, but there were big challenges in my lifetime, and I can come up with three. When I tried to have a baby and I couldn't have a baby, and we were blessed with the miracle of our son. It was early on in my career, and it was planned and desired, but after he was born, while I was breastfeeding, I was invited to my first international conference as a speaker. And I was so tempted. And I even juggled to see if I could carry the baby with me and bring it to the airplane and everything. But it was in Mexico and there are higher altitudes. So it was not a good decision to do that. So I decided to stay home. And then I decided to take care of my child very well at home while working for the first 3 to 5 years of his life. The first trip I took, it was after he was 3 years old, and with the support system I had, I could manage that, and that was right, and it was good for me. The other one was while dean of the dental school, we were celebrating our 60th anniversary, and we were all excited. We started our planning in January, and then Hurricane Maria hit the island, and it was a total devastation, so I had to shift the celebration into rescue operation and trying to be there in emergency mode. So that was a major shift for me. The other one was while I was thriving as dean, and we had gone through the hurricane and the school was able to graduate our students in time, and we were great with accreditation, and I was the first dean from the dental school to be at the admin board at the Council of Deans of ADEA. There were political pressures and internal, external, and they asked me to step down. So those for me were the three major shakers that made me prioritize and made me think about things and challenges and how to overcome them in a second.
So as I ponder to respond to that question, I'm a type A personality, and probably 99% of folks are on this call are probably the same, maybe, possibly. And so I plan everything. My husband says, you plan our kids, and I did. And my first child I had during my postdoc fellowship at UC Berkeley as a Barbara Wood Johnson Fellowship, a health policy scholar. And my second child, I only have two children, was 6 years apart. In retrospect, I should have went 4, but nonetheless, I was trying to afford college education. Those things went into my planning, and didn't want to have two kids at the same time footing that bill. So as I look back, I've always sought out opportunity. And each experience has allowed me to grow and to really expand my skill set, and it's provided me the training to move on and up the ladder. And so when you have children, moving around is not ideal. In fact, I admire my colleagues who've been at one institution 25 years or ultimately retired and have only been at one place, and that has some value. Not to say would I ever change anything, but I think if I had to maybe consider my children finishing high school, for example, my oldest kid, I think I would have done that differently, allow him to stay. I've been in a situation in which my husband has been the caretaker in terms of our children to allow me to pursue my career aspirations. And so there was one point in which they were living in one state and I was living in another because we had yet decided on terms of what would work best as a family. But ironically, as I share my story, I hear of other women who have been in similar situations, because we often hear that it's quite common for men to leave their wife, their spouse, in one state while they pursue their career aspirations. And so I share more because even though, I mean, we're looked upon, it's a double standard. And I've had even women leaders who would look down upon me in a less favorable light because I left my family. But my situation is my choice, my decision. And it didn't impact my productivity, my ability to do the work. So we have to change the mindset in a way in which everyone's household, family, you make decisions that's best for you at that time, right? And so would I have done it differently? I don't know. But again, they've been able to thrive. I have a husband who's poured into them, as we both do. And it's quite unique because, you know, I'm raising two sons and they've had a unique experience. So I'm not wishing that if they decide to marry, that they marry a woman who's, you know, doing all the things that I'm doing, but nonetheless, to have an open mind to define what's best for them as they move on in life, of career aspiration and having a family.
Well, I'm thinking as Chiquita and Ana were both speaking about the times that I've made decisions that shifted my priorities, and there are way too many of them for me to list, but I'll highlight just a couple. One of the most important things that happened for me early was that when my wife and I became partners, there's a 15-year age difference between us. She's 15 years older than me, and was an OBGYN practicing solo rural OB while I was practicing solo rural family medicine. We had 5 phone lines coming into the house, public and private, plus a fax machine for each of us. And those were in the days before cell phones. And the first thing that happened for me was that I stepped out of clinical medicine in the hospital fairly early in my career because somebody had to stay home and feed the dog. And that was a conscious choice that I didn't regret at the time and never have, but it was a career decision that I made sooner than a lot of people expected me to. I also began to realize that at the stage of life where I am now, I wanted my life to be flexible enough that when she was ready to retire, I would have time. That's what prompted me to look for an encore career. And that's a large part of how I became a coach. So I think that primary relationship was a driver for decisions that people around me didn't expect. Didn't expect me to make as early in my career as I did. So that's a set of things. The other thing that I think is probably important here, Chiquita and Ana talked about having children. I don't have children, but I am in that generation of people who are caretaking parents. And when my father became ill several years ago, and entered hospice, I was a department chair in an organization where the leadership above me had changed in its entirety. And so it was a fraught time with a lot of change. And I lived about 10 hours by car from my parents. I made the decision to drive every other weekend and spend a long weekend helping my mom take care of my dad. And my wife and I talked about it. And I said, I'm willing to regret anything at work. And I'm not willing to regret anything with my parents. So for about 4 months, I made that trip every other weekend. And when they really needed me to stay longer, I stayed longer, even though I was a department chair. And with the leadership change, I eventually, after my father passed, chose to step down as department chair because it had been a long run. And I didn't know how I wanted my career to move forward, but I knew that I needed to take a pause. That's actually the time when I began my coaching business and stayed on as a faculty member and a number of other really positive things came out of that, but the catalyst for the decision was caretaking with my family of origin. So I'll offer those as my experiences and turn the questions back to the moderators.
Yeah, those are all really important perspectives. And thank you so much, all of you, for sharing your experiences. So for our next question, we had, what are you currently striving for and what are your current goals? And do you have any advice on how to define those, you know, as you move forward in your career?
Well, I can jump in at the beginning here. I have three primary goals right now. One is creating a life where I have time to spend with my wife, who did retire a couple of years ago. And so doing that while I'm also scaling my business is a challenge. But a friend of mine gave me a bracelet with a word of the year on it. And the word of the year for me is scale wisely. So it's that balance still between work and home that I struggle with. And then in addition to that tension, making time for walking and for gardening are my priorities at the moment.
I can chime in. As the incoming chair for ADEA right now, one of the things I strive for is opening the doors for women, opening the doors for underrepresented minorities and ethnicities and diverse individuals, and being able to help the next generation of resilient leaders embrace change and be prepared for what is to come. I think that I have still a drive for helping in that sense, and being able to be that inspiration and that opening of those doors for them, for me, matters a lot right now in my career, and to leave that sound legacy. Definitely work on my balance, my well-being, and that of my family. My son is now working, so my husband and I are empty nesters. So we have a little more time, but my husband wants to have more fun than work. So I also have to juggle and my life and career. But at the same time, I really am enjoying, because the area where I feel most able to serve is when I can create, and where I am in a position to create and leave a sound legacy. So that's why my priorities are right now. Thank you.
So my priorities, first and foremost, is to invest in self-care. It's easy to say it, harder to do it. And given the current climate that's going on in the world today, as a diversity officer, I tell you, try not to use sleep aids in order to stay asleep at night. And really trying to remind myself that I can only control what I can control. In the same vein, I'm trying to relinquish control, because oftentimes in terms of what you do reflects your office if you're the lead. And so delegating is a difficult task for me, because even though I do some of it, ultimately I have to give the final approval. And so instead of constantly saying, redo something, I'm going to take charge and do it myself. And that's not a good model to follow as a leader, because that's the purpose of you being in that position. You know, you hire people with certain skill sets so that they can do the work and you can oversee that. But that's a challenge for me, and that's a work in progress. I would say those are the two things that I'm somewhat striving for. And I look to concrete examples and those who are doing it better. Nonetheless, you know, I'm not going to beat myself up, just to know that I'm aware, and that at times in which I can incorporate, you know, those things in terms of wellness, and trying to not, you know, to allow people to work their magic and just, you know, allow it to happen, opposed to taking over. So. Those are two things that come to mind. Yeah.
Thank you. It was very important perspectives, and I'm sure a lot of things to think about. Now, you touched upon a little bit already, but I think we would like to hear if you have advice for people that are beginning to reassess their priority, and also, how can we identify changes in our goals? So again, the question is for the three of you.
I guess I'll start first in terms of just following that model, Sharon, okay?
Okay, we'll just keep going back and forth.
I think it's important each person has to evaluate and assess where they are in terms of the stage of their career, right? Advice that may be given to someone who is, you know, mid-career associate professor and may have aspirations on becoming a chair, division chief, whatever the case may be, is very different from someone just starting out, right, being a junior faculty member. So I would say that, you know, from my experience, you know, you want to get the lay of the land, you want to understand the organizational culture of which you're in. You want to talk to those who can provide constructive advice on how to navigate. Not every advice is going to be to your benefit, so you have to kind of weigh the pros and cons in terms of what is most beneficial to you. And I would offer, again, who do you emulate? Who do you see yourself? Who do you envision in terms of becoming? Invest in yourself in terms of your career development. Not everyone is going to nominate you, so you sometimes have to advocate for self, and that is the best advocate, in my opinion. And so, you know, whether your institution offers in-house opportunity, have a close relationship with your office for faculty, they know where all the resources are, right? Talk to individuals who are like near peers, those who are a step ahead of you. They can give you the best advice in terms of avoiding pitfalls or things that were very useful for them in terms of career development and success. And I will also say, you know, sometimes we have to take a leap of faith. And if there are things by which you see that are not necessarily present at your university, that's an opportunity. You know, you can take the bull by its horns and establish something, create something. And that is a testament in terms of your ability to provide a service or something that would benefit the institution, your department, unit, or the university as a whole. So again, don't shortchange yourself, you know, look for opportunity, seek out advice. If you don't necessarily have it in your unit, your department, or your university, there's so many that are part of various networks across the country in which you can tap into.
I can go. Is that okay with you, Sharon, and go the way?
Please. And I think you should start the next question. We haven't let you start anything yet. So.
Yeah, I promise. One of the things that I have experienced in my lifetime is that the right decisions are made when we are very conscious and self-aware of where we are in that stage in time. And I agree with everything that Chiquita has said. And I think that you have to do an introspection and reflect and self-aware where you're at. What is your purpose? What do you want to be in life? What are you aiming? Not everyone wants to be a dean, like we have seen in previously. Not everyone needs to be a department chair. Just search for what is good for you, what's your purpose, what are you passionate about? Once you have that, you have to set your goals. And then remember that in setting a goal, like many of us have learned through life, is that there's always a learning opportunity next to it. When I started my career early on, I was thrown into academic administration without any experience. So I knew early on that I wanted to learn about academic administration, not to falter again. And I learned through experience, but also through developing myself. And I've been an active learner all my life. And every time I've been in a different situation, I've learned. I've learned something new. And I learn every day, and then we all do. So be mindful of that learning. Set your goal also with a learning initiative right next to it and work for it. Sometimes I've been pushed to step out of my comfort zone, and it's not easy. Sometimes you get in your comfort zone and it's like, oh, it's so relaxed. I want to stay here for a while. Yeah. But if you want to grow and if you want to learn more, you have to push yourself. So every year when the academic year ends, instead of the new year resolution, I have a new academic year resolution. And I want to be better at what I do. And then I start thinking, okay, what do I want to do different this year? When I start my academic year. So I wanna learn about curriculum. I wanna learn about assessment. I wanna learn about leadership. Interestingly enough, when I did a talk some time ago, every leadership step that I took into becoming a dean and after being a chair, I was in a leadership institute or a learning institute along the line. And it was not out of planning or strategy. Opportunity came, I sought the opportunity and I sought the position. When I was at ELAM, and I remember up to this day when I had to interview the university president, he said something that stuck with me all my life. And he said, Ana, when you have a goal, that's your end. That's the end of the mark. You are gonna go through that path and don't be shaken or moved or deterred of your path, because there are going to be noises, there are going to be challenges everywhere. Just keep a straight line. Sometimes in some of those paths, you learn and other opportunities come along the way. So you have to sit back, rethink, reshuffle, and make sure if you don't have to change that priority or that goal. Because like we all have experienced, change comes. Life is a constant change. Change comes every day. So the leader for tomorrow is the one that is able to adapt to those changes, embrace them, and move forward. So sometimes I do this. I learned very early on a book that is The Power of Positive Thinking. And it's very, I mean, it's been there all through life, I guess. And it's I keep it to my heart. It's visualize, prayerize, and actualize. And I follow that motto wherever I go, even with my personal life. And it has worked for me.
I love you. There are a lot of tidbits in there, Ana, that I'm going to take away. So thank you for sharing that. I think for me, giving myself permission to reexamine my priorities was the first, it's not a trick, but it's the first tip I'll offer. You have permission to rethink this. That we're the whole day is the great renegotiation, right? And we've just watched everybody through the pandemic really renegotiate first with themselves and then with their employers and sometimes with their families, all their priorities. The other time in my life that that kind of event happened was right after 9/11. And I was the dean of students for my medical school on the day that it happened. And we were 3 weeks in to the year. And I just remember the various students who came in, including one who said, I need you to get me out of here. And I thought he meant he just needed to get home. And he said, no, I'm not coming back. 6 weeks ago, I was working in the World Trade Center. All of my friends and colleagues were there today. I'm going home and I'm not coming back to medical school. That's the moment I realized just how profound the change was going to be for all of us. And he embodied that. So I think situations happen in the world. Situations happen in our own lives. They can be positive or negative, challenges or opportunities, but there are a lot of reasons to rethink. And so if you took a look at the workbook that I shared with people, I encourage people to keep a top 10 list of your priorities. And to update it on whatever day of the year makes sense. For Ana, it's the beginning of the academic year, which I really love. For some people, it's their birthday. For some people, it's a holy day or a holiday. For me, it's typically, I'm predictable. It's at the beginning of a new year. And I try to revamp that list. And I ask myself, what is this season of my life about? What's happening around me in the world, in my family, in just the age and stage of life that I'm in, that I need to take into account. And the other thing that I do with that sort of annual review is I try to write my mission statement for the year. It's sort of the 50,000 foot view of my life. Why am I here? What am I doing here? And everything else flows from that. So those are my suggestions.
Yeah, that was a great question. Those are all really wonderful suggestions. And kind of following up on that, so Sharon, you had mentioned in the past that you know, there are decisions that other people didn't expect you to make, you know, when you reevaluated priorities. And you kind of touched on this as well and talked about, you know, breaking your comfort zone, you know, and doing what feels best for you. If I could just open this up to the rest of the panel again, I know, Ana, you gave specific examples, but maybe for other strategies of how you feel comfortable, you know, addressing situations when you're making priorities that not necessarily everyone thinks is, you know, the right path for you.
I have to jump in first. It's my turn.
Yeah, if you want to continue to tell more stories too, that's great. Yeah, keep it coming.
Two things that I forgot to say is that very early in my career, I learned that I have my me time. I have to take time for me. So my me time can be Friday at lunchtime. I take 2 hours out of my schedule. Now I take the afternoon off, depending on where you're at stage in your career. Sometimes it can't be a Friday because you have to do things, but then have X day of the week to have your me time. That's when I went out. I bought lunch for myself. I walked out of the building. I did my nails. I met with a friend and had lunch. That was my me time. I control, even when I had a child. So it's your time. Also, remember that when you are, you have to take care of yourself. So it's always good to have your checkups every day. And then I learned through the Hurricane Maria experience that I needed to have some time for me to exercise regularly. So every day, if I can, I walk at least half an hour. If I can't walk because it's raining, I stay home, but I do something. And if not, I dance. So it's just a matter of just moving and shaking. The other thing that I recommend, and now I think I'm not diverting from the question, but it's to celebrate the baby steps. For every major goal in your life, you have to celebrate the baby steps. Sometimes it's like, whoa, I finished my course. Whoa, I did this. Whatever it is, it doesn't matter how big or small, you have to celebrate. And then I also make sure that when I have these big decisions that may have an effect on my family, I consult first with my immediate family. You know what? I'm thinking about running for the deanship. My husband goes, really? And I go, yeah. And then he said, well, have you thought about it carefully? And I go, yeah. He goes, do you think you're up for the position? I go, yeah. And he goes, go ahead. But I have a husband that supports me. And he's, you know, he's supportive. Although he supports me, but when I get home, I have to do the dishes. If he cooks, I have to take the plate out of his lap, which I hate. But, you know, you got to do what you got to do. He's taking care of our son while I was away. My parents, no, my dad is sick. So I have to pay back for all those soccer games that I couldn't pick him up. And they did. So you have to make sure that you balance. And then I take them into consideration. If my husband was ill, I wouldn't take those decisions. If my son was ill, I wouldn't make those decisions. But they were the first. When I decided after being forced to step down from office, I had a very hard time because we were thriving as a dental school and I was thriving and I didn't have a plan B because everything was going well, so well. So I learned to always have a plan B and a plan C. I also learned that you have to take time to heal. I took my time the year after and they asked me, Ana, do you want to share this? Ana, do you want to say, no, no, no sharing, no, nothing. It's my time. When I'm ready, I'll be ready. And I then refocused and started working at IDEA, like a lot, volunteering a lot, and doing things that I enjoyed, that gave me oxygen. I never stopped teaching, not even when I was a dean, because that was my go-to place after. So you always have to have, you know, make sure that when you, what you like and you're passionate about, stay doing that, and then evolved. Another thing was when I decided to run for the chair position, I went back to my husband and he goes, really? And I go, yeah. And he goes, why do you want to do this? And I started putting all down all the reasons why. And then he goes, well, you're going to be traveling a lot, but that's good because I have free time. And I go, yeah. You know, you'll be having free time and you can come with me if you want to. So there are things that you have to negotiate and renegotiate. And definitely with my parents, they're both healthy. They were healthy when I decided. Now one of them is not, but I also have two siblings and we share. So when I'm here, I'm all in. And when I cannot be here, they're all in. So you have to balance and make sure that your decision doesn't, you're not stepping on the health and well-being of those around you that supported you. Thank you.
Chiquita, go ahead.
So two things come to mind in terms of just reflecting about my trajectory over the years. I learned a lot from my parents. I'm a first gen college student. My parents only made it to high school, but they were small business owners and invested in our education. So I would say two things: to know thyself. You really have to know, you know, where you want to be and what type of legacy you want to leave. It's important for me that those who I have learned from have built the foundation. You know, you stand on the shoulders of those before us. And I am obligated to give back to those coming after me. And so whatever, you know, profession in which I was pursuing as a young person, I knew that was core to my being. And so I remember just one example as a junior faculty member and being a woman of color, you know, the majority of whom did not reflect my identity. And there was a two-tier process by which they evaluated prospective faculty candidates. And in the social sciences, our primary, our premier season is in the fall. All institutions are competing for the best. And so they had, you know, a search that took place in the fall, but they also had a search for those who were underrepresented individuals in January. And so in my mind, that was a two-tier type of, you know, well, we'll put our energies in terms of the cream of the crop, you know, in terms of in the fall, and then in terms of whoever is left over. And so, you know, the advice given to me is that you have to pick and choose your battles, especially in terms of where you are, in terms of your tenure and rank. But I knew that if I didn't say anything, that you collude to a system that is unfair. And so I made it my business to vocalize, because we all should be reviewed in the same type of criteria by which you're seeking out the best candidate, right? And there are superstars who just happen to be underrepresented. And so they changed the process. I left the academy in terms of, in the traditional sense, and many people felt that that was career suicide. However, I knew in my heart of hearts that I wanted to do more. And so there is value in terms of traditional academia, but my heart has always been in medicine and health. My prior life was health disparities research. I made a little name for myself, but nonetheless, I wanted to do more. And so I took a leap of faith. I'm not saying that anyone on this call should do the same in terms of my experience, but I'm just sharing in terms of what may or may not resonate with you, that you have to, again, know thyself. And if you feel as if you're not necessarily meeting your own expectations, sometimes you have to get out of the bubble and find out what works for you. And so I did. I did work at a national consulting firm as a senior lead, and they decided to change the agenda and found myself looking for work and saw that a prestigious place on the East Coast were looking for someone at a lower level. But let me tell you, being a graduate of the University of Michigan, they taught us how to negotiate. So if anything you should learn in terms of ELAM or any opportunity, learn how to negotiate. And so I negotiated for a higher level, which equated to a higher salary. And from there, the gates just open up in terms of where I am today. So I would say, trust thyself, be bold, be courageous, and know what you want to leave behind in terms of your legacy.
Wow. I'm not sure how much I have to add to this, but I'll throw a couple of my pearls in. I think that Ana brought up having a plan B and a plan C. And I have always been what I euphemistically called myself as an options keeper. I like to keep my options available to me. I don't have to broadcast them. But this ties to the way I look at the leadership jobs I've had in my career. I think there are three kinds of leadership jobs. There's building something from scratch. There is turning around something that needs to be fixed. And there's keeping a steady hand on the tiller of a well-functioning machine and taking it to the next level. I think each of us are wired to do one or maybe two of those really well and to thrive in them. And the others do not appeal to us. I ended up finding myself in a fix-it job, a turnaround job, without realizing this difference. And that's when I realized that if I was going to actually fix things, I was probably going to make people mad, and that I needed an off-ramp in case that happened. And that actually is how things played out twice in my career. And I realized that I was becoming known for fix-its and that I was pretty good at it, and I kind of liked it. But if I was going to do fix-it work, I needed a plan B. And so I learned to enter a job saying, okay, what skills do I get from this job? What exposure do I get? What experiences do I get that will prepare me for whatever plan B or C is? And it's just that sense of always assessing what I'm learning, what I want to learn, what might be the next step. And the humbling part of that whole story is that you have to realize that the best laid plans often go awry. So you can plan all you want, and a hurricane or a pandemic or something like that hits, and everything's back on the table. So it's that living with ambiguity about our careers that I think is the common theme I'm hearing from all of us. Mm-hmm. So I think that's what I have to add.
Yeah, thank you. Everything is so inspiring. So we got a great question in the chat. I would like to read it for you. Janet Fitzpatrick said that you are very confident and inspiring women, you all. So, and I agree. Did you ever struggle between being confident and feeling worthy versus having imposter syndrome? And if so, how did you overcome that?
I will jump in and say, I'm sorry.
No, you go, Sharon. It's your turn.
We're not really keeping a tally sheet, but we're trying to be fair to each other. I think I will say, yes, I have had what I felt to be imposter syndrome, where I felt like I was, somebody was going to find me out, that I didn't belong there. And I came to find out that that actually happened for me whenever the delta between what I'm comfortable with and what I'm being asked to do gets wide enough. It's like a rubber band, and there's a tripwire on the rubber band. When that distance gets big enough, it trips something, and this little gnome crawls out of his cave and up on my shoulder and starts telling me, you don't belong there. They're going to really figure you out, right? So that's my experience. But I think there's been some really phenomenal work about not telling women in particular that their experience is actually imposter syndrome. They might actually be having an experience that is institutionally biased or an unfair system, And it might look like imposter syndrome to some of the rest of us, but their own experience is not that they're an imposter. It's that they're being told they're an imposter or something different. And I want to be careful about how I use the term, but to say for myself, yeah, I've been afraid that I would be found out every time I had to climb up the ladder. So I'm curious what Chiquita and Ana have to say about that.
So I want to take a different spin. I know in terms of the imposter syndrome that it's quite pervasive, and they say that most adults experience whether you're male or female.
Yes.
So that's the reality, right? I think there's an issue of perfectionism that can also derail one's ability to grow in terms of their career. And I'm guilty of it. In years past, there's some, I would say, tenets of that that's still part of my DNA. But you get to a point, for example, where you're so self-critical of yourself that it's not good enough, right? And so, prime example, I remember writing a paper many years ago, and it was not good enough. The reviewers came back, and you know, one was rejected. I mean, you have to have thick skin in the academy. That's the reality. but also, when we strive to always be the best, and you know, it could be from various factors, my own being as well as being a woman of color, that we're judged differently. And so we have to exceed expectations in order to be considered, you know, qualified, you know. So that has been somewhat a reality throughout my career, right? And so, but it can potentially derail, you know, so you have to be able to say, you know, I'm going to let it go, relinquish. We all make mistakes. We're all human, and not be so in the business of the perception in terms of the judgment that is so prevalent out there in the world, you know. So, you know, been in this business for a while, and I know that maybe those who are younger in their careers may feel that, but know that just, you know, find ways to navigate, make sure you have a tribe or network in which you can rely on that can understand your challenges and barriers, because you're not the first, you won't be the last, unfortunately. But again, you have to have a support system that can, you know, smooth out the bruises, know that you're going to be okay, and we will achieve higher heights. You know, you just have to know that, you have to believe that, and you have to see that in terms of the many examples that are so prevalent in our institution, in our careers, in other places.
Yeah, I agree with everything that has been said, but I have to admit that English is not my first language. I speak Spanish every day, all the time. So whenever I think in English when I start speaking English, because I went to college in the States, and I learned very early on since kindergarten. I was in private school, so I was blessed with the opportunity. But that comes with a weight, because you have, you know, I want to do leave a legacy and be purposeful, there you go, and open those doors. So I have imposter syndrome. I have imposter syndrome all the time, but I work and I, you know, execute, pray, seek for advice, do what I have to do. And most of all, because what I'm doing is what I love to do and what I'm passionate for, I mean, it just goes away. It goes away because I need to make sure that I open those doors for representation. I have that legacy on my shoulders, and I want to do that. So I seek my mentors, my advisors, my friends. And when I feel like I'm shaking, I also rely on faith. And I also rely on doing what I have to do. Because if I do things well in advance, I can review them, have someone else look at them, and make sure that where I'm headed to is the right path. I have angels. I have told this story many years, I have many stories of people that you don't know, or colleagues, or even persons that work where you are at, that become your angels. I remember one day while walking and just walking down the hallway from the deanship, the dean's office, someone from maintenance goes, "You know what? You got this, doctor. Put your head up high and you got this. You're going to be great." I didn't ask for anything. God sent that angel. So I learned very early on in my career to have a listening ear, be grounded, be grateful, be humble. Because you're, like Chiquita says, standing on the shoulders of those that came before you, and you have a purpose and you have a passion. So go for it. Dream big. I read somewhere, and I teach that to my students every time I talk to them. Sydney Poitier said something that was told early in one of those award shows, and it stuck with me. When your dreams don't scare you, they're not big enough. Mm-hmm. So that takes all the imposter syndrome that I ever, it gives me the chills and the bumps today, even today. But the dreams don't scare you. They're not big enough. So go ahead, dream big, and you'll get it. You'll be fine.
Wow.
Those are such great words of advice from all of you, and especially for me being quite junior in my career at right now, you know, feeling imposter syndrome a lot. This is, you know, really nice to get this perspective from everyone. And actually, this is a good segue into another question in the chat by Rochelle. She was actually the previous WIMSC postdoc representative. So great to see you on here, Rochelle. She said, "Thank you for all your advice and for sharing your stories with us. How important was a sponsor or sponsors in determining your career trajectory into leadership?"
I will say that, and I'll be very brief. I think many of us have experienced career setbacks, or sometimes they rise to the level of career traumas. Like many of you, I have had a couple of those. And when the first one hit, I was so stunned. But a dear colleague who happened to have been my boss, and then she stepped down, sat with me when I was processing what was happening. And she said, "Listen, you're going to get through this. And when the time comes, you should never be the one to tell the story of what really happened. But that story needs to be told. So when you tell me that you are ready, I already have a list of about 5 people around the country that I will pick up the phone and talk to and say, you really need to talk to this person. Whatever you've heard about what happened, you need to talk to her. Here's the real story." And that woman was a sponsor and a savior to my career, one of those angels Ana talks about. And her telling that story telling my story on my behalf quietly in her network opened the doors for the next plan B in my career. So that's my sponsor story.
You don't know who your angel can be. And I have had around my career many angels, sponsors, male allies, and woman allies. So, but I've also had the experience, like most of us, that sometimes women may not be your allies. So you have to make sure that you listen carefully, that you search and learn about your culture. Because one of the things I've learned to work to master my culture, my internal and external culture, and my national culture. You have to read, listen carefully, and listen. Your sponsors are going to open up and be there for you when you don't even think about it. I had this dean when I, early on in my career, that I wanted to be part of the dental school. And he goes, "Well, if you want to be part of the dental school, you have to do a specialty, or you have to go into public health. You have to do something else besides your DMD degree." And he was the one who pushed me into getting my DMD degree. I saw him in a funeral from another professor from our school. less than a month ago. And that sponsor didn't knew I was the chair for ADEA. And he was very happy when I decided to run for the deanship of that position. He was the one, when I graduated from my master's in public health, who gave me the honorary ribbon, because I it was the first time ever in my career, because dentistry is hard, like medicine, that I had straight A's. So it was like, oh, I made it. So it was an ego booster. So he was the one who was there at my graduation. When I decided to become a dean, I, out of a blue sky, he was walking down the hallway in the dental school, and he goes, what are your plans? And I go, well, I don't know, doctor, but I may be thinking about, because this has to change. This school's culture has to change. This climate has to change. And he goes, what are you going to do about it? You know, I'm thinking about running for the deanship. And he goes, go for it, but stay quiet, walk silently, and don't tell anyone. Just make sure that you do what has to be done. And he was there to support me. Now, when I saw him at the funeral, he was so happy because I'm the first one and the first. And he goes, I am so proud of you. Make Puerto Rico proud. Make sure that you open those doors for Hispanics, for Puerto Ricans, for all underrepresented ethnicities and minorities. And I have that on my shoulders, but I don't have I have that I can rely that people have faith. And when people have faith in you, you walk up and you just do what you have to do. So those are my energizers, my stabilizers, my allies, my sponsors. Those are the kind of people that become your angels.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry to cut. We are out of time. We know there are questions in the chat that maybe our wonderful panelists can answer later. I'm sorry, Nancy, I also see you had a question. We can continue this conversation in other ways. Thank you so much. This was really wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Collins Lopez and Dr. Ho. It was really inspiring.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Enjoy.
Thank you.
Learn from all of you.
Take care.
Bye.
Thank you. It's an honor. I'm grateful to be here with friends and colleagues. Thank you.
Yes. The privilege.
Well, I want to emphasize Andrea's closing remarks there. This was a really informative session, and I think I can speak for us all, saying that we have a bunch of tools and thoughts to bring with us as we start redefining our own priorities.